Hello, today I'm going to present multilingual part of speech tagging with bidirectional long short-term memory models and auxiliary loss. This paper was presented at the proceedings of 54th annual meeting of the Association for Computational Linguistics in Berlin. So the motivation of this paper is in general for sequence labeling tasks, bidirectional LSTMs perform better than other models. But during the publication of this paper in 2016, there was little research on the effect of bidirectional LSTMs on several languages, which have different characteristics and different input representations or embeddings. Data size as well as level noise. So the motivation in this paper was to figure out or to evaluate the effect of bidirectional LSTMs on these several parameters. So bidirectional LSTMs or LSTMs in general are recurrent neural networks, class of recurrent neural networks, and especially LSTMs are designed to prevent the problem, so-called vanishing gradients. This vanishing gradient problem is associated with neural networks which use back propagation. So as the magnitude of the gradients becomes very small, or as it gets reduced exponentially, the gradients or the network weights vanish. So the LSTMs solve this problem by introducing gating technique, where it blocks or passes the information. So if along the path of the layers, if all the values are one, then this will help to the network to remember the values, the previous values. So this is generally how it solves the vanishing gradient problem. And in bidirectional, the information is read backward and forward twice along the sequence. So in this case, a sequence in this research, because this is part of speech tagging research, a sequence would be a sentence and the tokens are the words. So in this research, the authors, they researched over different language families that contain around 22 languages. And they also compared the performance of different levels of representations. So these improved representations include word embeddings, character level embeddings, and byte Unicode embeddings. They also, as previously mentioned, investigated the effect of bilistms for training data and level their tolerance for noise of labels. And also they proposed a new approach whereby the auxiliary loss is added. We will talk about this later. So in general, the method in recurrent neural networks allows computation of fixed size vector or the input vector that we the word embeddings and other embeddings. This has to be fixed size vector representations for word sequences of any length. So an RNN is a function which maps the input values given here as x1 up to xn into some hidden layer output hn, and this hn depends on the entire sequence, on the entire embedding of the sequence. So in bidirectional recurrent neural networks, the input sequence is read twice, from left to right, and also from right to left, or forward and backward directions. And then this information is encoded and concatenated together. So for sequence bidirectional RNNs, the input will be a sequence of vectors. And as these are two types of, in this paper they mentioned two types of bidirectional methods. One is sequence bidirectional RNN, and the other one is context bidirectional RNN. So the difference between these two is the way the data is read. So as given in this equation, for sequence by RNA, the data is first read from, say, from left to right, or given here as 1 to n, and backwards from 1 to n, and then this data is concatenated. Additionally, in context by RNA, in addition to this configuration, the position information of the vector is also added. So the data is read from the first vector to position I, and then backwards from position I to n, and this information is concatenated together. So in this paper, they use the second one, which is context bidirectional RNA. So this is the picture depicts the two models. The first, the one on the left side is the proposed method, and the one on the right side is the journal method. So as can be seen here, the loss function or the cross entropy loss is an addition of the tag information, and also the method introduced in this paper, which they call log frequency level. So two of this information is added. So as you can see here, we have this information coming. For example, this is a word, it's encoded, it's read forward and backwards, and it's encoded here. And on the output side, we have two outputs. So first one is the tag, or this vector here, and the second one is the log frequency level, which we see here as 1 FQ0, 1 FQ2, and so on. So here they encode both the frequency information and also the word vector information, as opposed to this one. Here we have only the tag as output, so only the tag information is encoded here. So the intuition for adding this log frequency information or level is they wanted to create a representation or a different representation of the rare words and the frequent words. So if this information is not available, then the representation of the words will be passed to the layers as it is, but the network may not be able to figure out which one is the most frequent and which one is the rare words. So they have added this log frequency information in order to represent or to create a different representation of the frequent and the common words and the rare words in the network. And this, as we can see in the result, had a great impact on improving the performance, the overall performance of the network. So by using these methods, they constructed some models. The first basic model is the context bidirectional LSTM. It takes as input the word vectors only. And there are also other sub-token level representations where they just represent characters or embeddings, and also Unicode bytes as embeddings. Then they concatenated also this word embeddings and the character embeddings, and also character embeddings with byte Unicode embeddings. So they created several models by combining and by also using only the word, character, and the bytecode embeddings. These are the same parameters that they used over all their experiments. So they used the CNN library for neural networks. Hyperparameters are set on English development sets. So they used gradient descent for their training with cross entropy loss and 20 epochs. Default learning rate is 0.1. They used 128 dimensions for word embeddings and 100 dimensions for character and byte embeddings, 100 hidden states, and Gaussian noise is 0.2. They also used pre-trained word embeddings, and they used pyglot embeddings for that. So they used two data sets. One is from the Universal Dependencies Project, version 1.2. This data set contains 70 part of speech tags. The other one is from Word Street Journal, 45 part of speech tags. So for languages which have token segmentation ambiguity, they used the provided true segmentation with that data set. And they selected 22 languages, where they could find more than 60,000 tokens in them. So these are the languages, 22 language groups. So they contain Semitic languages, Slavic, Germanic, Romance, Indo-Iranian, Uralic, and so forth. So next we're going to see the results. So this is the overall results of the models. So we see the languages and also the group, the language family or the group they fit in. So this is Indo-European languages, non-Indo-European languages, Germanic, Romance, and Slavic. And we have here the overall or the average accuracies listed. So they compare the LSTM configurations with the traditional part of speech tigers, which are TNT, which is based on the Markovian principle, and also CRF method. So they use this as baselines and improve it by using different representations. So we note some important results here. The first one is the TNT tagger performs well, closely followed by CRF. So when compared to with TNT and CRF, when comparing TNT and CRF, TNT performs very well when compared to CRF. So we can see here that the average is 94.6 and here 94.2. So strange enough, the TNT performed well in these experiments. The expectation is that CRF should perform well because this is specialized for sequence labeling model. But anyway, here in these experiments, TNT performed better. The next observation is for the word embedding model, they confirmed that it only outperformed the other traditional methods, the TNT and CRF, only on three languages. So this model was performed better than these two traditional methods, only on three languages. But as we can see here, this plus on the cosines, they signify that these are the best representations. These are the best representations. So for the character alone model, it improves over TNT on nine languages. So only the character embeddings, the result was better when compared to TNT on nine languages. So these results. And they also combined the different representation units, as can be seen here. But the better performance was achieved when they added pre-trained word embeddings. So these embeddings only are from Universal Dependency Project dataset or the Word Speech Journal dataset. They use their own embeddings. But when they used another PyGlot-based embeddings pre-trained on other data, the performance, as we can see here, the bold figures are the highest performance in this configuration. So by using BILSTMs, they achieve better results by using more embedded information. And in here, when we compare both these two methods, so these are the regular bidirectional LSTMs with this information. And when they used the loss, the auxiliary loss, when they added the auxiliary loss of the frequencies in 12 of the 22 languages, the performance was higher. So they concluded that the frequency information, the low frequency information added to the network was able to help the detection of, especially out of vocabulary words, because the representation helped to differentiate the rare words and the most common words. So as said here, the overall best system is the last one here, 96.52. This last result is another comparing to another research which was previously done, and as we can see here, these results performed better. But however, these results were based on different data sets of the Universal Dependency Project, and these were based on newer version of that dataset. So they are not strictly comparable, but this method also uses the same dataset as this research. So we, as you can see here, this is the improvement for of the loss. So as the network, as the this shows that there is minimization or reduction of error as the number of the log frequencies increases. And this is a result which shows comparison with the WSJ dataset for different research. So this research with bidirectional LSTM based on word vectors and character vectors was competitive when compared to other research, to other similar research. These figures show the performance of the bidirectional LSTM with frequency, with low frequency by language families. So these are Indo-European language families, non-Indo-European language families, and so on. So as we can see here in this TNT, this this blue line represents TNT, the red one is bilstem, and the orange one is CRF. So for the initial stages, we see the TNT outperforming the other two methods in most of the cases. The blue graph represents the TNT, so it these are number of sentences for a short or for few number of sentences or for little data, the TNT performed better. However, starting from around 500 sentences, the bilstem takes over and performs better when compared to the other models. So generally it can be said that LSTMs perform well when the data size is more. And in these experiments, they showed that the LSTM was able to perform well only after 520 sentences. So the general consensus was that very huge or very large data sets are required for deep learning methods. But in this research, they were able to show that of course, very large dataset is used, but not so large dataset is needed to outperform the traditional methods. So one thing to note here is for Semitic languages, which include Arabic and Hebrew, Tigrinya, Amharic, also in this research, they researched on Arabic and Hebrew only for Semitic languages. So we see here a different trend, and starting from the beginning, for Semitic languages, LSTM was performing better. So even for low data set size or for large data set size, according to these results, using bidirectional LSTMs would be recommended. So the final result on a report, the final report on results is about label noise. So they artificially introduced noise or corrupted the training labels to see the tolerance of the methods when the data has some noise. So at low noise rates, the methods show generally a drop of accuracies, but at low noise rates, the same degree of drop of accuracies was noted. But when the noise level is much higher, more than 30% of the levels are corrupted, then they see that bidirectional LSTMs are less robust to the noise. So in conclusion, in this paper, they evaluated token and subtoken level representations for bidirectional LSTM in part of speech tagging task for 22 languages. And they also proposed a novel model which they referred as bidirectional LSTM with auxiliary loss. And this method added with pre-trained embeddings performed better in the experiments. The auxiliary loss is especially effective at improving the rare words or the out-of-vocabulary rates. And subtoken representations are necessary for to obtain a state-of-the-art part of speech tagger. So only word embeddings were not performing well, but when they added subtoken or character representations, the accuracy improved. And among these, the best representation was the subtoken plus word embedding in hierarchical networks. So in general, the bidirectional LSTM is as effective as the other traditional models with only 500 training sentences. So it's not necessary to have a large or a huge data set when doing bilSTMs. And finally, bilSTM tagger was less robust when exposed to label noise at higher noise rates. Thank you very much.